I want to thank you all very much for inviting me to Vizag. I'm very sorry I'm not there. And the reasons are that I have been caught in the middle of this RTI amendments, and there's also the food security bill and so many things happening in Parliament. And when Parliament is in session, I somehow feel that my campaigns and my commitments keep me somewhere near Delhi. And there are also this is also a time when I cannot predict what may happen at what time and where I'll be needed to lobby or to be part of a delegation or something. So I'm most sorry I'm not with you. Nevertheless, you will have people like Shailesh Gandhi and others will be there with you today to talk to you about the Right to Information. I'm basically going to say that the Right to Information Act, as I see it, is basic to India's democracy in a much more fundamental sense than even fighting corruption. It is an act which will demand the citizens to use it, and by using this act in many different places, we will ensure that that Indian democracy remains participatory, it remains proactively with the constitutional principles that were enshrined and Free India agreed to put into practice. It is also the security of every citizen to see that the state does not take their rights away, does not impinge on their fundamental sovereignty, and keeps it secure. What happens when you cast a vote, or I cast a vote? Actually, we cast a vote and we transfer the sovereignty that we have with us as a constitutional right to an elected representative for 5 years to operate it. Fundamentally, this is what is called a symbiotic relationship, that is like a mother with a child, one part of the organ with the next. So in a sense, political parties and political leaders are connected to the citizens of India in a very fundamental sense. That is why the recent amendments, to keep them completely out of the purview of the Right to Information Act, has come in for so much criticism. There are numbers of issues which that has thrown up. It is true that some part of the activities of political parties may not be possible to use to disclose parts of the functioning of the political parties, but that they move to keep themselves out of the act raises numbers of issues. In fact, when the act was first drafted by Justice Sarvant in 1996, he in the team that put this act together, the first Right to Information draft together, which is known as the Press Council draft, they included all public spending bodies under the purview of the act. So you had public authorities and public bodies. So all religious institutions, NGOs, trade unions, political parties, anyone who collected public funds for a public purpose came under the purview of the act. Now, government did not keep public bodies and kept only public authorities. Now, these are issues which you should debate in your college and your universities. Try and find out what it all means and how it leads to some kind of understanding of the need for transparency and accountability in a country in which 60% of the people are below the poverty line. Even the poverty line debate needs transparency and accountability. How can you define the minimum requirement of a poor person in a village as 23? And you say that a person who lives in a town can live on 32, while the people who make these policies live on exorbitant salaries. Is it an ethical issue? Is it an economic issue? Is it a fundamental issue of equality as economic equality as enshrined in the Constitution? What are we fighting for? So when you really go into these democratic debates, if we do not have the right to know details of how all these accumulated data is collected, how the process of numbers is arrived at, we can't arrive at a proper conclusion, and our battles will all be lost. So it is inevitable that Right to Information is part of every act of ours, whether we are participant in the government structure or we are citizens outside the government, but engaging with the government as we have to do in getting our licenses, our gas connections, our electricity connections, building houses, going into universities and schools and colleges. Everywhere we are engaging with the government system And most of us feel it's better to engage with the government system than with a private body, because at least the government system is somehow, somewhere accountable to me and you. But a private body is not. So there's this big argument that essential services and many other wings of the state should be managed by public authorities, by government, but be fully transparent and accountable to the citizen. It is in this context that I would say that the debate should go today, and really those of us who have not used the RTI will use the RTI. But let us not forget, I want to give a series of examples, what it has done for us in the last 8 years. What it hasn't done in terms of commissions and what it hasn't done in terms of its Section 4, other people will talk about. But I just want to encapsulate some of the great ways in which participation has doubled, quadrupled because of the RTI. In the case of Kashmir, Bashir, who lives in a border village, was looking forward to the Chief Minister's visit to his village because he thought at least when he comes by road will be set right. The Chief Minister flew by helicopter, a small 35 kilometer bit that was not motorable, to his village. The road never got built and Bashir was exceedingly annoyed. So he put in an application asking the government of Kashmir how many times the helicopter is used, what fuel is used, how much it has cost the CM, and what are the minimum distances he can cover, and when is he authorized to take the helicopter. The result was that a huge issue got uprooted by this, and the CM had to answer questions, and now he goes only when he has a motorable road, or when the road is there but which is not motorable, probably he indulges in repairs of that road and travels, and people benefit. I mean, it is an example of what you can do in a state like that. If you take ordinary poor citizens, whether it's the PDS or health or teachers not teaching or maternity benefits not coming, if it is a range of issues, so many hundreds of thousands of people have done it. And like remote Shillong or Manipur or Himachal Pradesh, right up in Lahul and Spiti to Kanyakumari in Kudankulam, they've used RTI to get information out. Most of the predominantly discussed corruption cases have come through RTI applications, basically. So has this judgment. This RTI application has brought this judgment whereby actually political parties are now obliged to disclose their accounts. So there's a huge range. If you look at it, to make all these issues work, you need every single part of the mechanism of government to be made functioning and functionable. For that, you need individual RTIs which are filed in hundreds of places, because it's the one tool that we've got to monitor. What the RTI question does is a very powerful thing. It asks for a share of power, it asks for a share of governance, and it actually asks for the right to decide about what will be a priority and how that will be done. And it asks for absolute accountability. And I think it is a seminal act, it's a very important act. It emanates from a constitutional right under Article 19.1. And we therefore feel that this right to information can be called a transformatory act, as Mr. S.R. Shankaran once defined 3 years ago in Hyderabad. So I really think we now have to look at the second generation problems of the RTI, look at the ways in which we can take it further. And I'm sure your conference and this whole workshop will be a grand success, and I hope to meet you all very soon. Thank you.